So you're interested, we're going to start a conversation.
Hello. Hi.
Hi everyone. Good afternoon. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining us today. Also, thanks for everyone that is joining us online. My name is Alberto Carrillo. I'm Chief Technical Officer of the SBTI, the Science Based Targets Initiative, and we are very happy to have this discussion today. We're going to be talking about the Forest Land Use and Agriculture Guidance that SBTI released a few weeks ago. We have a great set of panelists and speakers, and also a very interesting agenda. To start with, I'm going to tell you a little bit about the SBTI, what we do, who we are. Then my colleague Krista Anderson, that was one of the co-leads for the PLAG guidance development. She's gonna tell us more about what the PLAG guidance is, what it covers, why it was important to develop this guidance. Then we have Scarlett, who is our lead for beyond value chain mitigation. Scarlett is gonna tell us more about what it is and why it is important, and how PLAG targets can help us address the climate and nature crisis. Let's get started. So first, let me talk about the SBTI, Science Based Targets Initiative. is an initiative that started 8 years ago as a collaboration between four organizations working on climate with the corporate sector, CDP, WWF, the UN Global Compact, and WRI. And we've been working with the Women Business Coalition since the beginning to drive the adoption of climate targets that are in line with what science says is needed to limit warming to 1.5 degrees. And we focus on four key areas. The first one is to develop standards and guidance to inform the adoption of targets by companies and by financial institutions that have the integrity and the ambition that is needed to ensure that we can transition towards a net zero economy and that we keep achieve climate stability in line with what science says is necessary. Then the second part of our work is focused on driving the adoption of targets. And we work with a wide range of partners and through different mechanisms to drive up the adoption of targets amongst the most impactful companies on the planet, to really make sure that companies take the action that is needed to achieve climate stability. The third piece of what we do is to provide assurance on the ambition of climate targets set by companies and financial institutions. We conduct detailed assessment of the targets. We make sure that targets meet the ambition criteria that that are defined in our standards. And the fourth element of our work is basically focusing on finding ways to accelerate ambition and to embed the concept of science-based target setting in different parts of the ecosystem. Now, we have around 4,000 companies that are already in different parts of the journey of setting science-based targets. Around 2,000 companies, a little bit less than 2,000 companies, have already moved from the target setting to the target implementation phase. And we have around 2,000 companies that are in the process of setting targets. these companies covered around one third of global capital markets, global market capitalization, and about 96% of the companies that are setting targets have included already full value chain emissions in their targets. About three quarters of the targets that are part of the SBTI are 1.5 degree aligned. And in our progress assessment that we conduct every year, we observe that companies are actually reducing emissions at a rate that is consistent with what they committed. And so we believe it's critical to scale up these mechanisms to ensure ambition and integrity in target settings so that we can achieve the global goals that we have. Now, as part of what we do, we develop, as I mentioned, sector-specific guidance. And so we're going to talk today about the guidance for land use-related emissions, but we also work on development of guidance for other sectors. We recently published also the guidance for cement. We just finalized, we haven't published yet, the guidance for shipping. We are currently doing consultation on guidance for steel sector and are in earlier phases for other sectors. For instance, we are developing a net zero standard for financial institutions. And we are also looking at the transition for the energy sector. Now I'm going to hand over to Krista, who is going to talk more about the FLAG guidance.
Wonderful. Thanks so much, Alberto. And I think there's a slight lag, so I apologize for that. Just shout out somebody if you can't hear me or if something's not working correctly. But I wanted to talk specifically about the FLAG guidance. As Alberto said, our newest sector development guidance. And the starting point here is that agriculture, forestry, and other land use, or AFOLU, as we call it in the IPCC, these emissions and under UNFCCC represent 22% of global annual greenhouse gas emissions. That's more than a fifth of our global emissions are from the land sector. AFOLU, as it's called in IPCC, or FLAG, as we call it, under science-based targets, FLAG for forests, land, and agriculture. So it's a significant share, and actually it's something that we hadn't comprehensively had included in science-based targets previously. So in many cases, companies weren't including the share of emissions in their inventory. And then of course, they weren't able to set targets against those emissions. So what we did is we developed this specific sector guidance for FLAG. I'm going to talk in just one level more of detail about what does that look like to have FLAG guidance to be including these land emissions now in the corporate emissions that companies will be setting targets against. And of course, when I say land emissions, it really is quite expansive. So any company, of course, that deals with food or agriculture or paper products or forest products in their supply chain, FLAG can apply to them. And any company that has significant land-based emissions will need to set a FLAG target. Of course, the number one thing, I'm showing number one in this slide, is setting these near-term FLAG science-based targets is now fully developed and an opportunity for all companies within science-based targets. And these are all, FLAG targets are all in line with a 1.5 degree future. The second thing, and this is really important about FLAG, is that when a company accounts for these land emissions and sets a target against them, we're talking about, of course, the emission reductions. We need to reduce our emissions from where we've been to where we need to be in a 1.5 degree future. But as in number two says, we're also accounting for removals, carbon removals from the atmosphere. We know that in the land sector, a huge part of the mitigation work to get to 1.5 degrees is in doing removals. So sequestering more carbon in our soils and more carbon and biomass in trees especially. So that's really part of the work. And this is something new in science-based targets. Generally, of course, targets are really focused on reducing a company's emissions over time. But as I said, since removals are so important in the land sector, that's now a part of a company's targets, an opportunity and an obligation to address what's needed in mitigation on the removal side. The third thing I really want to mention about FLAG as we bring these land-based emissions into the target setting framework for science-based targets is that we've also included a no deforestation commitment. So when companies set and submit their FLAG targets covering their land emissions, they'll also need to set a no deforestation commitment. And the reason for this is that emissions from deforestation are a really significant share of all of those, that 22% of AFOLA emissions. It's a land use overall is about half of that, and deforestation is the lion's share there. So it's such an important source of emissions that we included it as a specific required commitment. The other part of this is that many companies have already set a no deforestation commitment. And so we wanted to ensure that, you know, that there's really strong alignment between the company's climate commitment on one hand, and then of course, the elements that overlap into a forest commitment on the other, and that there's not any kind of tension there. The fourth thing, and this may seem obvious, but of course, companies who are setting their FLAG targets are still going to be setting science-based targets for their energy and industry emissions. So sometimes folks can think that, okay, if you're setting your FLAG target, it's sort of subsuming everything else. But in fact, what we're doing is adding on the land emissions, adding on a target to cover those land emissions, and still keeping all of the traditional targets, the energy and industry targets, whichever one is used by a particular company in the mix. So it's really an adding on. It looks a little bit like this. So companies have their energy industry target covers all of the fossil emissions, of course, and the plan for reducing those. And now with the launch of FLAG, companies who have significant emissions from the land sector will also have a FLAG target. The FLAG target, of course, covering all their land-based emissions. There are two main approaches for companies to be able to set a FLAG target. And this is something we developed looking at sort of what is the state of the science and what are the needs of companies as they're doing their planning and for mitigation around FLAG. So the first opportunity, and this really the default for companies who are setting FLAG targets, is this top line on the right, the FLAG sector pathway. It covers all emissions in under AFOLU, under FLAG in the land sector. So it's looking at a mitigation pathway that includes forestry and agriculture, and of course, livestock, and also demand side options like food loss and waste and diet shift. All that's included there. as I said, this is really the default option, and it's especially intended and directed for companies who are in the initial stages, as many are, of accounting for the first time for all of those land-based emissions, and for the first time setting a target against them. Well, that's the main option. The second option for flag target setting are our commodity intensity pathways. That's the second sort of section below on the right. These are really aimed at supply side actors. And what we did here is for 11 major global commodities where there are significant emissions, we developed specific pathways for what mitigation is needed for this specific commodity in a specific region. So things like wheat, corn, palm oil, soy, timber and wood fiber, also livestock, so cattle, poultry, pork, leather. Each of these commodities has a specific mitigation pathway under flag. And so companies who are major producers or traders or sellers or users of any of these commodities, if they're on the supply side, they can set a commodity-specific target in addition to potentially their flag sector pathway so that they have an encompassing flag target that's specified to what is the mitigation that this company needs to do in this region of the world. I think with that, I will pause and I'll be looking forward to taking questions after this, but I want to turn it over to my colleague, Scarlett Benson, to say more.
Hi, everybody. Nice to be here. My name is Scarlett Benson, and I've recently joined the SBTI to lead the work on beyond value chain mitigation, which I will explain what that is. Could we have the slide, please? So you may recall the Science Based Target Initiative launched the Net Zero Standard ahead of COP26 last year. And it's on this side, right? There are really four elements to that. So Chris has talked a little bit about the first one, which is these near-term targets, which for most sectors are just emissions reductions, but for the land sector also includes removals from within the value chain. The second piece of the Net Zero Standard is the long-term reduction targets. To 2050 or by 2050. The third part, which you can see under this graph here, thank you, under this graph here is the beyond value chain mitigation, which I will describe in a moment. And then the final bit is the neutralization of any emissions which are deemed kind of infeasible to abate at the end. And those have to be sort of counterbalanced through permanent removals. So what is beyond value chain mitigation, this number three piece? So really the starting point is that if every company in the world set science-based targets, in theory, it's very unlikely we would even get to net zero at that point, because there are emissions which fall outside of the value chains of companies. They may not yet be appropriately captured within nationally determined contributions. And so we have this sort of ambition gap. And we know that climate finance is absolutely nowhere near where it needs to be today. And so there is a role for companies, for the private sector, to go above and beyond these kind of minimum abatement targets to contribute to societal and global net zero. And so the SBTI is really strongly encouraging companies to make these investments now and in the transition to net zero, and you know, even potentially beyond. And so this is not a requirement of the science-based target net zero standard, but it is a strong recommendation. Now, over the next year or so, I will be working with the SBTI to develop the guidance around what beyond value chain mitigation means. And it's really structured around kind of the five W's. So what is beyond value chain mitigation? I can say for sure right now, where we've landed is that it is both carbon removals and reductions. But you know, it could be other types of investments. Lots of people often think that beyond value mitigation is just about buying carbon credits. You know, we're seeing it as much broader than that, more kind of other types of catalytic investment. So really defining what counts. Where is climate finance needed in the system, and where can we direct companies in terms of their, you know, their investments? When is climate finance needed into certain solutions? Obviously, we're here talking about land sector today. We know that there are many ecosystems which are close to these tipping points, which potentially mean that they would release huge amounts of carbon into the atmosphere. And so investing into nature today has to be a real priority. But obviously there are other very important things that we need to invest in. For example, we know that we're going to need lots of removals at 2050. We know that there are some emissions that are infeasible to abate. And not all of those removals can be delivered by the land sector. And so we are going to need technology-based removals, which are currently very expensive. And so investments today need to happen to start to bring the cost of those technologies down. So that's a bit about the when. When do these investments have to happen? The next is who. So who makes beyond value chain mitigation investments? And I think the crux here is about how do we allocate responsibility to different actors? There are some sectors which have, you know, are going to have an expensive journey ahead in terms of decarbonizing their own value chains, the harder to abate sectors, whereas other sectors have maybe lower emissions, but much higher profits. And so we need to think a little bit about how do we allocate responsibility to different actors so that we're taking into account maybe things like willingness to pay, ability to pay, capacity to pay. So this is a little bit of a challenging one because it's not entirely something that we can define and refer to science. It's more about a kind of equity decision. And then the final W is why. And this is, I think, a really critical one. Why would companies do this? What I always say to this answer is, why have companies set science-based targets in the first place? I mean, this is still voluntary. But as Alberto was describing, we have more than 4,000 companies, more than a third of the world's market cap. These companies are doing this in the absence of regulation because they see that it makes business sense. And I think you can kind of translate that argument over to beyond value chain mitigation. As I said before, we will not reach net zero unless corporates start investing beyond their value chains and we significantly increase climate finance. So I think, you know, there's certainly kind of a moral and business imperative to invest, but perhaps there are some other incentives that SBTI, and maybe others working in the NGO space can create, as also kind of in the regulatory space as well, in order to encourage companies to go beyond. One of those things might be a claim. You might have heard of the Voluntary Carbon Market Integrity Initiative. They're looking at claims as well. So these are all the things that we want to look through, the what, the when, the why, the who, the where. So how does this relate to nature? Can I go to the next slide? So as I said before, you know, there are these tipping points and nature's clearly very underfinanced in comparison to other things within the system. And I think, you know, this for me is a bit of a, so why when you invest in nature, you have almost a double impact. So you reduce the emissions associated with the loss of that nature. And you also protect the capacity of that hectare of forest, for example, to continue to sequester carbons to continue to sequester carbon into the future. And if you restore nature, then you also enhance its capacity as a sink. So nature has a very, very important role in climate, in the climate story. And maybe just to say kind of in addition to that, so yeah, within the standard, we certainly will be wanting to encourage companies to invest in nature. But as I said, there are other kind of important investments that are needed too. My final point that I just want to make is around a parallel initiative called the Science-Based Targets Network, which is currently working to develop science-based targets for nature. So it's really building on the work of the Science-Based Target Initiative and looking at a broader set of metrics. So SBTI is sort of solely focused on greenhouse gas emissions, whereas Science-Based Target Network is looking at freshwater, biodiversity, eutrophication, a wider set of metrics. And as you can imagine, it gets a lot more complicated when you add more metrics. But this process is very important because eventually, well, they'll be publishing the version one of the science-based target nature targets in Q1 next year. This is really critical because an investment into climate isn't necessarily good for nature. Even an investment into nature, to land sector emissions removals isn't good for nature. Planting, non-native species that grow very fast, great for climate. not great for biodiversity and nature. And so having these nature targets that really make sure that when companies are kind of looking at how they invest in nature-based solutions, it's delivering outcomes for both. So I think it's going to be, you know, it's clearly an evolving space, and there's a lot for companies to take on board with the new flag, with the Beyond Value Chain Mitigation, and with the nature targets, but it's an absolutely critical piece of within the infrastructure. Sorry if I went on a bit long there.
Thank you very much, Krista and Scarlett. So actually, it was perfect timing. We have enough time to have a number of questions. So let's start here in the audience to see if anyone has any question. Please introduce yourself, and then, yeah, please share a question.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gabriel Quintana from Institute of for Agriculture and Forest Management and Certification. And Brazilian NGO, where we work with sustainable agriculture and certification. I got a question because with the flag sector, that's it's a very good for Brazilian sector also. We have there the GHG protocol with emissions, Brazilian emissions of factors and removals. And with the flag, the guidance, it's saying that we're going to have to use the new tool of the GHG protocol. How are we going to match these both tools? Because the Brazilian ones have the national mission, factor emissions, and the other has maybe worldwide emissions factors. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Krista, would you like to take that one?
I'd be happy to. Thanks for that question. It's a really important one. And for those who might not be familiar in the audience, it's a really great topic to raise. We talked about FLAG, which is the new guidance for target setting. At the same time, together with Greenhouse Gas Protocol, there's going to be new guidance about how to do your emissions accounting in the land sector. Of course, Greenhouse Gas Protocol has been the lead in corporate emissions accounting for decades now, and they're writing new guidance, which hasn't existed before, about how companies need to report on and account for their greenhouse gas emissions related to land, as well as all removals. So that accounting guidance is new. It's currently in the second draft and will be finalized next year. With that accounting in hand, companies can set their flag targets. The question that I'm hearing is, how does that accounting guidance reconcile with the accounting that a company or any other kind of jurisdiction might already have in place? And what's important to know is that the Greenhouse Gas Protocol is providing a framework. So it's saying what kinds of things should be included in the accounting, what approach should be taken, what kinds of land management emissions fall into scope one versus scope three, how should a removals be accounted, and when is permanence an issue that needs to be considered, those kinds of questions. But the guidance, it doesn't provide specific emissions factors. So those emission factors would be used by a company for whatever's the most appropriate for where that company is working and what's being sourced. So I'm not seeing a direct conflict, as you're saying, with those emissions factors. Of course, the specific data that's used for the accounting, it really needs to be specific to a location, to a company. And then it's the Greenhouse Gas Protocol who's saying, how should those be added up? What's the framework for that? And then flag for the target setting. Once you've accounted for your emissions, how much do you need to reduce them? And that's what flag can tell you.
Thank you very much, Krista. Next question, please introduce yourself.
Hello, I'm Stefan from TRIO. We provide carbon, nature-based carbon removals. And we have exactly the question you raised in the end. I've seen in Uganda, Indonesia, where we plant a lot of monoculture forests. Like in Uganda, I was in the eucalyptus forest, totally dead. No insect, no bird, no other living species except the 10 hectares of carbon removal forest. And as you said, you are science-based targets. So how do I find the science in measuring biodiversity that I can tell my customers we do forests with smallholder farmers, which is biodiverse, which has animals and all the other aspects, which I cannot measure right now so easily.
Thank you. That's an excellent question for Scarlett.
Thank you. Yeah, so nature's a bit more complex. In climate, we have a kind of global mixing of greenhouse gases, and so it doesn't need to be as spatial. So with nature, actually what matters is the local biome and how much biodiversity, how much that ecosystem is able to function and provide ecosystem services, which is quite different to climate. So maybe I can just explain a little bit about the process that we're going through with the Science-Based Target Network. I often say when people say, when it's going to be ready soon, and we're like, we don't have the IPCC, we don't have 1.5 degrees, we don't have emissions factors, you know, we don't have the greenhouse gas protocol. With nature, we're building a lot of this. There's a lot of good work that's happened, but it's not been kind of standardized. So we're looking at place-specific thresholds of nature to understand what is the kind of ecosystem intactness and the ecosystem functioning that needs to happen at a local level. We're trying to think through how to allocate that responsibility to different actors, and then understand how we can help corporates, because we're not necessarily expecting them to measure everything on nature everywhere, because that just becomes orders of magnitude too complicated. So we're developing these things called characterization factors, maybe a little bit technical, but allows companies to understand, if I implement this practice, so if I shift to no-till agriculture, or if I plant this type of tree in this location, what is the likely impact on soil organic carbon, on species richness, et cetera. So as I mentioned, we'll be developing the version one of the methods early next year. And then we'll be moving towards more sort of spatial targets over the coming 2 years. So there'll be targets by the end of 2024 is what we're aiming for. So that infrastructure is being built. But I think what you can say to a company today is that these science-based targets for nature is coming, and you want to make sure that they're kind of future-proofing their investments and making sure that, you know, if they're reporting to Task Force on Nature-related Financial Disclosure in a year, that they can prove that their investments into climate are also good for nature. So, it's a bit further behind, but I'm really seeing a huge like wave of companies saying that they want to be nature positive, and there's a real kind of sort of vibrant level of ambition. So, I think at the moment maybe it's a story, but you're pointing towards these things that are coming.
Thanks, Scarlett. I would just like to add something to what Scarlett mentioned, which is both in the SBTI and in SBTN, we follow a mitigation hierarchy, right? And I think what we need to aim for is we need to keep carbon where it is, right? That's the first priority. Carbon that is underground needs to remain underground. Carbon that is above ground needs to remain above ground. First thing that we need to avoid is to take more carbon out of the underground and to protect the carbon that is already in our ecosystems, right? And I think if we manage to do that, I think the rest is, you know, easy to resolve. And so I would say, yeah, I think we need to think always with mitigation hierarchy perspective.
Yes, the question, just for clarification, I saw it in the list of requirements. Oh, could the list AICA? Yeah. I saw within the list of criteria under the flag, a no deforestation commitment. Within that framework, just for clarification, how do we deal with companies whose business is essentially, for example, timber extraction? How do we deal with them within the framework of that flag?
Thank you. Krista, did you hear the question clearly?
Yes, very much. Thanks for that question. Of course, we timber companies are still included in flag targets, and the no deforestation commitment follows the guidance of AFI, the Accountability Framework Initiative. These are the folks who are really the leads in saying, what does a no deforestation target look like? But of course, when we say no deforestation, what we mean is no land use change leading to deforestation. Of course, still, we expect there to be many actively managed timber and forest lands that are from time to time harvested and then regrown. And so that's not at all prohibited as part of a no deforestation commitment. Flag fully covers all timber and wood fiber companies.
Thanks, Krista. Next question here.
Hi, hello. I'm Juanita Lopez from KPMG South America. And I would like to know, for us starting to work with companies around TNFD, how are you linking, how do you see this, like, or do you recommend this is approach, the science-based targets for nature with the TNFD work?
So they're working very closely together. I think the network hub of the Science-Based Target Network, they are in weekly meetings with the TNFD. So they're really trying to align the two frameworks. How I see it is that TNFD is about, it's about understanding risk. And you have a part of that, which is about setting targets. And so TNFD is essentially pointing to SBTN, the Science-Based Target for Nature, on that piece around target setting. So there's very clear alignment. They're also doing a lot of discussions about the data that's needed for companies to report to TNFD and to measure their baselines and then ultimately set targets. So there's that. Yeah, there is a lot of alignment essentially.
Thanks, Carlett. Any other question? Clarification? No? Okay, great. Well, thank you, everyone. I think it has been a very interesting discussion, very interesting questions. And yeah, we invite you to look at the resources on our website, sciencebasedtargets.org, and we're still here if you want to discuss something more specific. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Krista, for joining us remotely, and everyone that is joining us online as well. Thank you very much, Scarlett, and thanks everyone here in the room. And thanks also to our host for this event. Thank you.